For the last 25 years, I've been running workshops on how to plan research. And my motivation is I see too much research that just won't work. I see too many papers submitted that you think, well, you could have done that much better. So I don't want you to do things that just aren't going to work. You're too busy. You want to make a success of life. And we run this course overseas for master's courses, run it every year for the Student Conference in Conservation Science here in Cambridge. In fact, I'm doing that today. And it's a process we call reverse planning. And I should say this, we're thinking about ecology and conservation, but these ideas apply to almost all research. So in reverse planning, you're thinking backwards. You're starting with the answer and thinking, how do I get there? And the way to think about this is the key answer is the graphs and tables you've got to produce. So if you're a PhD student, then you can think about it. You've got to produce, say, four piles of graphs and tables, four chapters, each with perhaps 10 graphs and tables in, so 40 in total. If it takes you 4 years, that's less than one a month. That's kind of easy. And then once you've got your graphs and tables, you just need to write some text and bind it. That's the easy bit. If you're a master's student, then perhaps you only need 10 or 15 graphs or tables. If you want a paper in Nature or Science, you just need 4 graphs and tables. So life's easy. You very much need to think about how you're going to produce interesting graphs and tables. So this is the process of reverse planning we think about. Firstly, what's the specific question you want to answer that's interesting and important? And that is a difficult stage. Secondly, what analyses do you need in order to answer that specific question? Thirdly, what data is needed to create those analyses to answer that question? Fourthly, how can this data be collected? What we call a research protocol. What are you going to go out? How many days? What action are you going to go and collect? Fifthly, is it practical? We'll talk about how you estimate if you've got enough time and how to modify things if you don't have enough time. Don't run something where you're going to run out of time. And then finally, if, as is often the case, it's not going to work, what are you then going to do? We'll then discuss that. So this is what we call the process of reverse planning. So the first thing to think about are, what are the questions that you're going to select? And here is the questions that we give to the students. If you're feeling keen, you can switch off the video now and answer them yourself. And then once you've done that, come back. And I recommend you doing that. But otherwise, let's keep going. Number one, what's the ecology of the lily-pilly burrowing crayfish? What do you think of that? Well, that's not really a very specific question. These are intended as questions for a year-long research project for a team of 4 people. You know, you really want to think of something actually quite specific. Secondly, what are the most important forests in Cambodia? Again, the same problem. That's assessing everything in all forests in Cambodia. It would be impossible. But you might say, which of the national parks are most important for lianas? Or which of the big forests are particularly important for primates? Or something like that. What are the habitat requirements and diet of the shoebill, a type of stork, in Uganda? That seems quite a doable and practical question. What's the population size of the no-eyed big-eyed spider? The big-eyed spider is a group of spiders, and the no-eyed big-eyed spider lives in larval caves in Hawaii. It might be an interesting question. I'm not really sure it's a very exciting question for a year long, but that's up for you to decide if that's sufficiently important. What's the interaction between development and conservation in Kenya? Again, much too broad. Really need to think about something much more specific. Pick one element of that. 6, what are the main pollinators of the military orchid in the UK? And does this differ between the two sites in the UK? not terribly exciting, but that's kind of quite a reasonable, doable project. You know, have a team of people watching a team of orchids and see what's going on. How does habitat influence the breeding success of the snoring rail? So looking at habitat selectivity and its consequences often makes good projects. You can imagine going to a range of different habitats and seeing how well they're breeding. No idea how practical that is. And then finally, does the presence of logging camps reduce the local abundance of primates in Brazil? This seems quite a good project. You can imagine going to a range of different logging camps and perhaps some sites where there aren't logging camps, taking transects into the forest, perhaps looking at the extent of logging and the abundance of primates as you go in different distances, and doing that in a number of different sites. And you could visit probably quite a few sites over a year. So that seems quite a realistic and sensible project. So once you've identified your interesting question, you're then going to think, what analyses am I going to do? And really, there are four main ways in which you're going to present your data. Firstly, as graphs, and your graphs could be histograms, bar charts, or they could be scattergrams, looking at points and looking for correlations. Secondly, they could be tables, and tables are often sneered at, but tables are a really good way of presenting data. Occasionally, you might have maps, but that's normally if you want to show the distribution of a problem across space. And then finally, you have facts. So you might say, here's a specific fact that I'm going to look at. So the point I'm making is that you can take a question and then you can start thinking, what are the graphs and tables that I'm going to produce? So let's give an example. So when I last did this exercise, someone said, how could you look at avian influenza and seabirds and see what the consequences of that might be? So I said, what you might do, if you've got previous surveys in that site for different years, you'll have the number of birds, you've got your previous surveys, and then you'd say, this year when the avian flu has struck, is it going to go down? Might it go down a bit more next year? And then will it recover? And how long will it take to recover? Secondly, you might say, well, let's look over a season. So you do it on different months, and you look at the number of seabirds that are present in those different months, and you look at the number that have avian flu, and you look at the number that have died. And then you might look at to think about what are the factors causing the spread. If there's some cliffs that you can look at, you might look at different heights. So divide those into four groups and look at the percentage of individuals that get avian flu. And if you're higher up, do you get less avian flu than if you're lower down? Perhaps because these spreading the disease, those higher up are spreading the disease with their feces, etc., to those lower down. So the point I'm making is that you can take a problem and you can quite quickly think of graphs and tables you can draw. And my main message is to really encourage you to do this. Ex-PhD students and postdocs will know that this is something I always push. Think of the graphs and tables and draw them out. And if you do draw these out, and I stress it's often a painful experience because you're planning your research. It's a difficult thing to do. Don't worry if it's a bit of a challenge. Keep going. But if you do this, you can then show that to your friends and say, I'm thinking of doing this. What do you think? You can show it to your supervisor. Your supervisor will probably be delighted to see this, because almost certainly your friends and your colleagues and your supervisor will say, what about doing this? What about if you're collecting this data? What about doing something else? What about collecting this other bit of data that you could do? So it very much leads on to improving your research. So the one lesson from today, draw graphs and tables. So the next stage, so you worked out what data you need. The next stage is to think about how you're going to collect it. And we call this the protocol. So the protocol is we're going to see whether or not there's data on these colonies already. And it's possible someone's going to collect them in the same routine way this year, in which case we could just see if we could use that data, perhaps in some collaboration. Or if not, we'll perhaps there's some old data and we can go back and collect it in the same way. And then we need to visit each of these sites each month in order to look at the number of birds that are there and the number of birds that are showing signs of avian influenza and the number that have died. And then we need to find ways of dividing up nests according to those that are in the bottom of the cliff and the top of the cliff, and then how we're going to assign those, and then how we're going to look at the fate of each of those. And obviously, we're going to be efficient, so we're going to combine these, so we're collecting the data for these at the same time. So that's what's called the protocol. Your protocol is you think about how you're going to collect the data. And a useful way of doing that is thinking about the data sheets you're going to collect. You're probably not going to use paper data sheets, it's likely you're going to create data files, but really it's the same idea as having a paper data sheet. Think about what that looks like, and I really would create your data sheets well in advance and think about that. And again, show your friends, show your supervisor. And really, there are three sorts of data sheets. Firstly, there are single event data sheets. So I'm going to do a survey of the colony and I'm going to count all the birds present, and that's just a one-off event that I'm going to do. Secondly, you have continuous data sheets where you just, each time you see something, you then update it. So it might be that for each time you see a diseased bird, you might record some information on its behavior, and then you do that for every diseased bird you see. And then you have updated data sheets. So you might have data for each nest, imagine a sheet for each nest, and then as you come back, you record for the next date what you've recorded, and then you're continually updating that data sheet. So continuous data sheets could be for nests, or they could be for if you're marking and studying particular animals, or if you're studying particular trees or particular locations, and you keep going back and recording more data on that one location. That's a continuous data sheet, one sheet per location or per individual. So if you have those, you can then, this is your way of thinking about what data you need and how you're going to collect it to generate these graphs in order to answer these questions. The next thing to think about is whether or not you can do this, whether or not you've sufficient time available in order to do this. And this is a critical stage to do. We see lots of projects where people just run out of time. They can't do it. They collect lots of specimens which they don't have time to analyze. They visit some sites with the intention of going back and find they don't have the time to do so. So think about how much time you have. And the way to do this is to think about how long your season is. So, you know, how many months it is. And then each month, how many days are you going to spend working? You know, hopefully you're not going to work every day. You might have the weekends off. You might have to travel between sites. You might have other things you have to do. You'll have days when the weather isn't suitable. So you've got to be realistic about the number of days that you could actually work. And then you think about how long it would take to do each of these exercises. So again, this is the example we give the students. So, so here the question is, You've got to carry out 10-minute point counts for birds in a wood. After each count, measure the diameter and breast height of the five nearest trees. Then walk for 300 meters to the next point count. Wait for 5 minutes for the birds to settle down before starting the count. All counts should be between 6 a.m. and 10 a.m. How many counts can be carried out per day? So think about that. So I'll give you my answer. My answer is you wait for 5 minutes for the birds to settle down, do your 10-minute point count. I could probably do the diameter breast heights in 5 minutes, 5 minutes to walk between sites. So that's 25 minutes per observation. You've got 210 minutes. So perhaps seven or eight counts allow a little bit of flexibility for other things to happen. So perhaps realistically, 7 counts a morning. And you can then think then about the amount of data you can then collect over your season. We've added information from the teaching material, so there's a PDF from this material that you found in the description. So the what you can then do is then say, is your project feasible? Can you do your project in the time available? And very often you find that you can't. So what do you do? You go back and you look at the graphs you're thinking of producing and what compromise you're going to make. Are you going to attend for fewer months? Are you going to go to fewer sites? You know, think about what you're going to do with not enough, with less time in order to do it. And so what I've suggested here is a way of planning your research in order to have a realistic research project that you can do that will produce lots of graphs and tables for your thesis, for your publications, in order to answer the most interesting questions that you can answer. But there's a problem. The problem is that when you go out in the field, it's not going to be as you thought it would be. It's a wetter year. You can't get access. Your species are difficult to see. There's all sorts of different problems. So what do you then do? You do the same process again. You say, with these different constraints, what's the best thing I can do in the time available to produce the most interesting set of graphs and tables that answer the most interesting question? And the other issue is quite often when you're doing field work, you notice something new, perhaps there's a new problem, or you just realize something. That's very common in field ecology. What do you do then? It's exactly the same thing. You think about how you can take advantage of that, what graphs and tables you can produce in relation to this new issue, and then think about what is possible for your entire project, and then redesign it to take advantage of those new opportunities. So I hope you find this useful. My experience is this process of reverse planning really fundamentally improves the efficiency of students and postdocs research. So I hope you find it useful. I hope you end up doing something useful. And I hope you generate some really useful science. Good luck.